bump stops don't always get the attention they deserve in a suspension system. And when setting up your suspension, paying attention to what's happening with the bump stops is actually pretty important. So here in front of me, I've got an array of different bump stop types, all different shapes and sizes, which is pretty typical when dealing with bump stops. The normal function of a bump stop in, say, an OEM or road car application is really just to limit the suspension travel safely, to stop suspension components hitting each other when you've got large bumps in the road, say potholes or something like that. It's really just to stop the suspension crashing into itself, damaging suspension arms, dampers, things like that, or even the tire hitting the inside guard. The way a bump stop is typically packaged in a suspension is normally sitting on a damper such as this, and in a coilover application it'll sit inside there underneath the spring. So for the bump stop to become engaged, you've normally got a top hat sitting on here on top of the damper. The entire spring travel would have to be used up until the top hat comes in contact with the bump stop. At that point, the spring and the bump stop are working together to provide a resistive force inside the suspension. The rate of the bump stop in an OEM application is generally quite a lot higher than the spring. That's because you're really just trying to resist that last bit of force to stop the suspension components causing any damage when you're at or very close to maximum travel. And in a road car application, the amount of suspension travel you have is usually quite large compared to the bump stop, so it's not normal in road cars for the bump stops to be active much of the time. It's really much more of a case of a highly transient thing like a bump in the road or a pothole or something like that, or maybe even a really heavy braking event. Typically the rate of the suspension is controlled by the springs and the anti-roll bars, and the bump stops aren't usually that active. In race car suspension setup, you'll often hear the term bump stop gap or packer gap as the terms people often use to describe how they've got their bump stop set up. So what that's referring to is, let's imagine there's a top hat sitting on the top of this suspension here. So that's the essentially that top platform that the will bolt to the car. This gap between the top hat and the top of the bump stop when the car's at ride height, it's normally what people are referring to when they're talking about bump stop gap or packer gap. The reason they often use the word packer gap is because to tune the position of the bump stop or to tune that height, you often insert packers underneath the bump stop. So you'll have packers at different increment sizes, say 1, 2, 3, 5 millimeters and such, that you can slide over the damper shaft with the whole setup, with the whole suspension already assembled, to modify that bump stop gap. One of the simplest things you're usually using the bump stops to control is to just stop mechanical component clashes. So in a motorsport application where you may have large tires or you're running particularly low ride height, one of the things you're often trying to stop is contact between the tires and the fenders or the inner guard and the wheel well. So the tuning of the bump stop becomes really critical to get that right. Sometimes it means choosing a different bump stop, or it can mean tuning the packer gap, so adding those spaces I was talking about underneath the bump stop, so that when the suspension compresses, we make sure that the bump stop is engaged really hard before the tire comes in contact with anything. We don't want the tire to come in contact with anything, so we use the bump stops to control that. The rate of the bump stop is a function of things like material, shape, length. So you see here within this range of bump stops, there's some different shaft sizes, and that's really just a function of which damper they're designed to fit. So you don't really want the bump stops to be super tight on here. You want them to be a sort of a close sliding fit. You don't want to have to force one of these on. It should be able to slide relatively freely on the shaft. So the material, obviously you've got stiffer and softer materials. That certainly has an implication. The material choice also has an implication on how they react under temperature. So some bump stops will be, as the temperature changes, their stiffness behavior changes quite a lot. And that's definitely something that you need to consider if they are in quite a hot area of the car, say, particularly at the front of the car, if you've got a front engine car, the bump stop characteristics can change quite a lot with temperature. The shape is also really important to how the bump stops behave. So as the bump stops compressed, different sections will compress at different times, and that generally results in a progressive stiffness increase. So the more the bump stop is compressed, the higher the rate ends up being. That's really just to control. As you get closer and closer to your mechanical limit of your suspension, the higher the rate is,
to stop you bottoming out anything and causing damage in your suspension. Apart from using the bump stops to control things going wrong or having damage from tires hitting the inner guards or suspension components going beyond their travel, another important thing with the bump stop gap is tuning the bump stop gap such that the bump stops engage at a time where you do or don't want them to. For example, when you're in a corner and your suspension compresses a certain amount, what you generally don't want is to start engaging the bump stops while you're in a corner. It's not necessarily a bad thing for the bump stops to be engaged during a corner, but you don't want to be coming on and off the bump stop while you're in a corner. What's happening when you're transitioning from being off the bump stop to having the bump stop engaged is that suspension rate on that corner of the car is changing quite drastically. It's quite a big step in stiffness, and that can definitely have a big effect on your chassis balance, because essentially the corner that is beginning to engage the bump stop within the corner is having a large increase in suspension rate transiently just when the bump stop's being engaged. And again, it's not necessarily a problem to be on the bump stop, you just don't want to be coming on and off within the corner. So that's often what another reason you'll be using packers and different bump stop heights to try and make sure that when you're in a corner you are either fully on or fully off the bump stop to avoid problems with rate changes mid-corner. Probably the most common way to understand the bump stop gap or where you are in your suspension travel and if and when you're engaging your bump stops is to use something like a damper potentiometer. So this is a linear sensor that can slide in and out, and you can use that signal to tell you which corner of your suspension is in which position. So there's all sorts of ways they can be mounted. They can be mounted to the suspension. They're often mounted in parallel with the damper itself, so with a bracket from somewhere on the shaft or somewhere attached to the shaft and somewhere on the body. And using that, you can tell where your suspension is at any point of time when you're on track, which is not just useful for bump stop gaps, it's useful for ride heights and damper analysis and all sorts of things. Another reason we make use of bump stops is in high downforce applications. In a car with a really effective floor, say with front and rear diffusers and maybe even a flat center section, the ride height is really critical to the performance. It affects the downforce and drag a lot. We're using bump stop gap and material to tune the ride height both on the straights and in the corners, and that often comes once you've got your bump stop rate in the range that you need it. That often means changing the packer gap underneath the bump stops to get the floor in the ride height window that you're looking for. In high downforce applications such as GTs, prototypes and things like time attack cars, this bump stop gap is really critical because it controls the ride. It has a large bearing on the ride height. A difference in ride height of plus or minus a millimeter makes a measurable difference to the downforce. It really is that important, particularly at the front of the car. So what you often see is very high suspension rates, very high spring rates. You'll see very high bump stop rates and quite small gaps to the bump stops, such that the cars can even be running on the bump stops even when they're sitting in the pit lane. That's just because they're trying to keep that front floor, that proximity to the ground, in a very, very tight window. And as I said, a millimeter one way or the other will make a measurable difference in downforce. So that's how critical it becomes. You will often see, you know, packer sizes of 1 millimeter going, being changed in the damper. It's actually an area where race engineers and high downforce cars spend quite a lot of their time, both pre-event for simulation work and during an event, looking at the data to understand how engaged the bump stops are, where they're being engaged, what the resultant ride height is, and whether you need to make any changes to either the stiffness of the bump stop or the amount of packer you've got to control the ride height at a certain position on track. So the most common type of bump stop is a polymer type, like everything we see here. One of the things to be aware of with polymer bump stops is that they are very sensitive to both temperature and how many cycles they've done. So their characteristics will change over time. So their rate and their internal damping changes quite a lot as they're used. And as their temperature changes on track, their characteristics change a lot as well. Because of this, in professional motorsport, we often make use of a metal matrix type bump stop instead, which is essentially a whole lot of small diameter steel, stainless steel wires wrapped up into a little, almost looks like a large washer, and their performance generally doesn't change a lot over time. A bump stop like this in a high downforce application, it really has to be considered a consumable item. So their performance can change quite a bit certainly over the length of a season. And as a result, you've got to be quite on top of checking the stiffness of them, checking the condition of them, if it's something that you're using to control ride height in a really critical way. One tool you do have at your disposal to tune bump stop performance is to actually cut down the bump stops. That's a perfectly legitimate way of changing their rates, particularly in high downforce cars where you don't have a lot of suspension travel. The bump stops in OEM applications are typically much too large to be actually packaged on the shaft. You may only be talking about 50 or so millimeters of usable suspension travel, and that's greater than the entire length of some of these bump stops here. So it's perfectly acceptable to cut them down and affect their stiffness properties.
So that was a quick rundown on the basics of bump stops. Certainly a little bit more than meets the eye, and definitely a part worthy of your attention when you're getting serious with your suspension tuning.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.